Hi, welcome. Thank you for coming out. My name is Na’ama Rokem. I teach at the Department of Near Eastern Languages and Civilizations here at the University of Chicago. And I'm here with my colleague, Anastasia Giannakidou, who teaches in the Linguistics Department, and with Saeed Kashua, who will be a visiting artist through the Gray Center for Arts and Inquiry here at the university in the spring. He's a novelist from Israel. And the three of us are engaged together with a collaboration, an experiment that's supported by the Gray Center and by the Mellon Foundation about bilingual stories, bilingual knowledge. We're sort of trying to think about bilingualism within a humanities context, but in an interdisciplinary way. So just a few words from our project description. We're asking, what do bilinguals know? And you know, when you start thinking about it, there are multiple ways to answer this question from multiple disciplinary points of view, depending on how you ask it. You think of different types of answers. So our collaboration brings together a novelist, a linguist, and a literary scholar to try to create a kind of disciplinary bilingualism or multilingualism to give us multiple languages with which to think about this question and answer it, and just reflect on the methods that are employed in answering it. So through this project, Saeed is going to be in residence at the University of Chicago, and the three of us are going to teach a class that we're calling Bilingualism Laboratory. And we'll be doing kind of a series of workshops leading up to that. So one thing that I want to start with is just to point out that unlike many of the academic talks that are being given here today that reflect on years of research that has been done, we're here to talk to you about research that we're about to embark on. So there are a lot of open questions, and mostly what we want to talk to you about today is the questions that are driving this experiment and the interdisciplinary nature of this experiment and what kind of a challenge that poses and what kind of possibilities that presents. So before we start talking more about the project and about bilingualism, I just thought we should introduce Saeed a little bit more detail, since he's the visitor that we're able to bring to Chicago through this project. Saeed is a best-selling novelist, journalist, and a screenwriter. He's written three novels, all of which are available in really excellent English translations: Dancing Arabs, Let It Be Morning, and Second Person Singular. He also writes a very popular weekly column for a daily newspaper called Haaretz in Israel. And he's a creator of a very popular TV series titled Arab Labor, which is an award-winning primetime sitcom about a Palestinian family in Israel. And this year also a film based on his novels was produced and released in Israel, titled Dancing Arabs. Mm-hmm. And he's working on a new TV series, a drama that will be aired on Israeli television as well. So Saeed was born in Tira, which is a Palestinian city in northern Israel, which means that he belongs to the Arab minority, which makes up about 20% of the population in Israel, which in contrast with Palestinians who live in Gaza and in the West Bank, the members of the Arab minority in Israel are citizens of Israel, but they're not in all senses equal members of Israeli society. They have the right to vote, they can run for office, but the resources that they have access to in terms of land, in terms of budgets, in terms of power, in terms of positions of power, are limited. And under the shadow of the Arab-Israeli conflict, Palestinians within Israel are often seen as kind of a fifth column, or a demographic threat is sometimes a term that's used. They face racism, they face discrimination. So that's a very brief account of in a kind of what's the English term? Here's the bilingual. Yeah, you can help. Like a nutshell, right? Of the social and political reality that Saeed grew up in, and that his work comes out of. And we could probably spend an entire hour discussing the complexities of Israeli society and its the relationship of Israeli society to the conflict, and we could probably spend a whole day debating it, but for the purpose, that's not what we're doing today. For the purpose of this presentation today, I'd like you to just to think about it in terms of language, to think about the this complex social reality and the conflict through the prism of language, right? So rather than thinking about the relationships of Jews and Arabs in the Middle East, think of the complex coexistence of the two languages and all of the different forms of mutual understanding and misunderstanding and mixing of the two languages that exist for different groups who live in that space. Hebrew and Arabic are both official languages of the state of Israel, a fact that sometimes surprises people. And there's an Arabic education system. There's a population of Arabic speakers within Israel, as I said. And Said's work is fundamentally formed by this bilingual reality. He writes his novels and his journalism in Hebrew, which is the language of the majority in Israel. But for example, as a screenwriter, he presents and reproduces bilingual realities in which Palestinian Israelis move. His characters mix the languages. They switch back and forth between them and negotiate kind of the tensions that exist between them. And that's something that's very prevalent in his narrative writing in Hebrew as well. So thinking about this as a literary scholar, this is something that fascinates me tremendously about Said's work, but it's also very challenging. I kind of trying to think about this, I realize that I don't have a lot of tools not a lot of kind of conceptual analytic categories that I can apply to a phenomenon of language mixing. In the humanities, when you start thinking about it, we really have limited tools to think about bilingualism. We tend to organize our study of language and culture really by language and by region, right? We have English departments and French departments and German departments, and we tend to, a lot of our conceptual tools are based in these divisions, on notions of national literary traditions and their philology. And of course, you know, we think a lot about various forms of linguistic crossover. Translation studies is a very vibrant field that deals with how works of literature and other cultural products are transferred from one language to the other. But the cases of mixing are a lot more confounding for us. As I said, we don't really have a lot of conceptual tools to deal with that. So this brings me to where Anastasia and I are coming from to this project. So we've been having an ongoing conversation for a few years now as a linguist and a literary scholar about bilingualism and just kind of what is it, how do you analyze it, how do you think about it, what kind of questions does it raise, and also trying to think about how linguistics and literary studies can enrich each other as two fields in asking this question. What would it mean to think about bilingualism studies as a kind of interdisciplinary field in its own right, and what would it mean if the humanities played a very central role within that interdisciplinary field, right? So in the academic year 2012-2013, we were able, with the support of the Franke Institute for the Humanities, to co-teach a class that looked at bilingualism from several disciplinary perspectives and kind of tried to set up a basic toolbox for thinking about bilingualism interdisciplinarily. And what we came to deal with more and more, the way that we're setting up this conversation, is the fact that to date, bilingualism really has been studied mostly by linguists, by psychologists, by sociologists, by linguistic anthropologists, but not so much but by humanists. And what we want to develop is a kind of a distinctive humanistic approach to the question of bilingualism, and yet one that builds on the knowledge that has been created by all these other fields, right? So not to invent the wheel, but to take all this knowledge that exists about bilingualism and ask, well, what is it? What can we do with that within the humanities? So as a way of dealing with this challenge of thinking about bilingualism through these humanistic eyes, but also maintaining a dialogue with other fields that have dealt with it, what we're doing this year, we set up our experiment about sort of through the conjunction of bilingual knowledge and bilingual storytelling, right? What do bilinguals know, and what are the stories that are being told about it? How does that form of knowledge drive storytelling? How are narratives formed by the knowledge and the frame of mind that are distinctive of bilingualism? So what we're going to do today is we'll start by hearing from Anastasia about some of the existing knowledge that we have, especially from the field of cognitive psychology, about bilingualism. And then we'll sort of open it up to a dialogue with Syed about literature and bilingualism through his experience and his writing.
Great. Okay. So does this show, okay. Great. All right. So we will start with just some terminology to make sure that we understand what we mean by the word bilingual. Okay, so when we ask the question, who is bilingual, right there, a bilingual is, a person that speaks two languages or a person that can function in two languages. Function or speaking does not necessarily mean that they function and speak it, perfectly or super balanced in every area or domain of life. Okay. But a bilingual is a person that uses two languages, and by two, we mean at least two. Okay, so we understand the number two in a logical sense. So it could be two or more. And the person that uses two or more languages uses them typically in a domain-specific kind of way, which means maybe they use language X for work and language Y at home. And for many children, by the way, this is typically the case. And usually when we talk about bilingualism, some kind of metric of proficiency is assumed, some kind of fluency. However, we have, we also have like bilinguals, we have early bilinguals. So this is, again, just a small piece of terminology to be able to understand the various kinds of bilingualism that we have. Bilingualism is a gradient category. Not all bilinguals are the same, and not all bilinguals came to be bilinguals through the same paths. So we have early bilinguals. These are the children that become bilingual from birth. Children that are exposed to two languages from the moment they come to this world. We have late bilinguals. These are typically adults that became bilinguals by necessity. So they move to a new place and then they need to adapt to a new language. We have balanced bilinguals. So we have bilinguals that are able to perform and function in both languages to the same degree. Although to the same degree is always relative, but they are capable and strong and they feel that they do not have a dominant language. But then we also talk about dominant bilinguals or recessive bilinguals, that's another dual of this term, which are the bilinguals that have one dominant language and one less dominant language. You should also view bilingualism as something dynamic through one's life. So a balanced bilingual can become recessive bilingual in one language if they stop using it for a while. Or a child can start in a balanced way, but they may end up having one dominant language. And another very important category there is the one that we left for last, heritage speakers. So the heritage bilinguals are bilinguals that have a dominant language. Actually, we have a slide for them. A heritage speaker is a speaker that has a dominant language and they have a second native language. Okay, so typically a bilingual is separated from a second language learner, okay, when the second language learning happens as learning of a so-called foreign language, okay. But in the case of heritage speakers, we have a very natural situation in which they learn both languages at home, but only one is used in the society around them. And so the second language gradually becomes either, let's say, petrified or less used, and therefore it becomes kind of stagnated in terms of knowledge or in terms of use. Often in the case of heritage speakers, we also talk about incomplete acquisition of language. And there's in fact a group at the University of Illinois at Chicago that studies heritage languages. Heritage speakers are quite varied in knowledge and performance, and their knowledge is native, though it may be imperfect. We also included languages that are spoken in US homes, just to give you a sense of how pervasive bilingualism is. So these are the major languages other than English. That's what LOTE stands for there. I don't know if you can see it. Language other than English. Okay, so the major languages here in the United States are Spanish, so these are the heritage languages, Chinese, Tagalog, French, Vietnamese, German, Korean, Russian. Where are the other two? Oh, we skipped them. Arabic was one of those. Arabic is in the top 10 as well. So, yeah, 9 and 10.
I
you cut Arabic out. Yeah.
Again.
Yes, yes. Because Arabic is one of the 10. We can also see the patterns of colonization here and immigration, you know. But, okay. So now, why do we study bilingualism? Okay, and there is a lot of stuff one can say. I only have a few minutes here, and I will just try to focus on the study of bilingualism that is also relevant to the project that we are trying to build here. The reason that we study bilingualism and that it's interesting to study bilingualism is that bilingualism affects the mind. Okay, and it affects the mind in a general sense, in a way that experience generally affects the mind. We know this from psychology. We know that video players or architects or musicians and other people that have certain talents, okay, that this talent and the constant practice of this talent really has cognitive effects in particular, you know, it changes their cognition in particular ways. Now, bilingualism is interesting because unlike, let's say, with architects, we discover, and it has been discovered actually in research, that you know their spatial cognition, you know, substantially differs from that of a lay person. Okay, but then again, one could say, in view of that finding, that okay, well, that's maybe because that doesn't show that the experience itself changed anything in the cognition. They are architects because they had this different, you know, spatial cognition to begin with. With bilinguals, it's important to emphasize that bilinguals are not pre-chosen. Okay, nobody chooses to be bilingual. Okay, it's an accident that most of them become bilingual. They're just born in situations with language contact and in societies that speak more than one language. In a way, every society where you've got more than one language, I mean, it's accidental that you end up having more than one language. And certainly the fact that people end up speaking the two languages is not by choice, especially when it comes, you know, to bilinguals from birth. It's, in fact, it's probably the parents' choice to impose the language on the children. And to a certain extent, during their adolescence, is not the children's choice. So what is important about bilingualism is that we can see these cognitive effects despite the as independent of talent or any other inherent inclination that those individuals might have. So bilingualism is just a reality, a kind of experience that is imposed on you. And then that experience by itself produces cognitive change, okay, that in fact has been shown in recent work to affect, you know, actual structures of the brain, in particular white matter integrity. It has actually been shown by this lady. She's a professor of psychology at the University of York, Canada, Ellen Bialystok. She was our invited speaker here 2 years ago when Na’ama and I had the Frankie workshop. So she was the one that, you know, addressed the question of, you know, how bilingualism affects the mind. And she was also the one to show, she and her colleagues and students and collaborators, that showed that these changes are really deep. They are really pervasive and across various kinds of bilinguals, not just the balanced one, but even, you know, non-balanced ones. And that they are, you know, long-term changes in the sense that they go through late in life. In fact, some recent research that she has shown shows that bilingualism delays the onset, the appearance of Alzheimer by almost 4 years. I will be happy to talk about this research. It's actually, you know, quite interesting. And, you know, better than any kind of medicinal intervention would afford. Okay, so the question is then, why does bilingualism have such deep impact? Okay, and we're thinking in terms of bilingualism impact because we want to then go into Saeed's mind and see how his, you know, bilingualism has affected his writing and how he thinks that, you know, this bilingual writing can then produce a change in the society within which he lives. So it's quite far-fetched, but we'll try to make it meaningful. Okay, so why does bilingualism have such deep impact? Okay. Now, in order to answer this question, we need to think about the bilingual experience, the bilingual, the linguistic event that involves two languages. Okay. So in a linguistic event where we have two languages as opposed to one, okay, the bilingual individual, and I use here the pronominal she, not he, okay, she must, okay, although the convention in the English language is he, okay, so she must have sufficient grammatical knowledge of two languages, okay, two representational systems. She must, you know, consider, check out the social parameters of context of use. This is, by the way, something that monolingual speakers also do. So, you know, this is a formal situation. So I'm speaking now differently than I would have spoken at home with my children. Okay, we call this register difference. So people speak, you know, monolingual speakers also need to check register, but bilingual speakers also need to check register. And if they speak languages that also differentiate substantially in terms of register, for example, if they are Japanese, okay, they need to consider certain grammatical facts. For example, honorification that characterizes Japanese but not English. So that's again like a second level of differentiation that they need to consider in terms of register. Then they need to choose a language, and then, and that's the cool fact about it, they need to control intrusion of the other language during the speech event. Okay, so we know from psychology, there is a lot of research here. I'm happy to see Boaz Kaiser as well. He is a colleague of ours from psychology who has studied bilingualism in this university. So we see that, you know, we know that as we speak, as I speak right now, English, you know, Greek, my other language, is suppressed. And this is known as inhibition, and this is something that we bilinguals do all the time. It's part of what you do. But there's research that shows that, you know, the other language remains activated and actually, you know, affects, it shows up. So the logical problems of bilinguals then, as has been formulated most notably in Bialystok's work, is, okay, how come, so the bilingual speaker has two representational systems, okay, and they face a problem, just look at the red part, that is logically irrelevant for monolinguals, which is, how is language production confined to the representational system for one language, avoiding interference of the other system? Okay, so we need to avoid the noise. I mean, the other system exists. It's active as I speak. But, you know, I need to suppress it. And here is, you know, as they constantly do that, this is going to create change. And this is where we also find, you know, the effects of Alzheimer's. I'll be happy to talk about this. Okay, so in the question period, because now we have constraints of time and I want to give some time to say it as well. So it's a question of management. So, you know, bilinguals need to constantly manage. And notice, as I said, that if you consider, say, English-Japanese bilinguals with honorifics, one language has it, one language doesn't have it, they need to deal with this conflict, they need to suppress the conflict, and they need to be able to function naturally in, you know, the language of their choosing at each time. So this really produces a kind of mental flexibility. Okay, and by mental flexibility, we assume this, you know, this ability to be able to think about alternative representations and to be able to go from one level to the other while suppressing irrelevant information. Now, this mental flexibility, we're going to give you some examples of that. Okay, and it's important to notice that it starts early. Okay, so bilingual children show performance of monolinguals 1 year older in a variety of tasks that shows this flexibility. So I'll give you a number of tasks. So one task that people have tampered with is the symbol substitution tasks. Now I'm grossly like summarizing a lot of research here. So one test, for example, this was actually done with Hebrew-English bilinguals in the 70s, and it has been replicated in numerous languages. Okay, so they take the kids into the experimental setup and they tell them, okay, now we are going to create a new language. And in this language, instead of we, okay, we're going to say spaghetti. Okay, just an arbitrary choice. All right. And then they ask the children, how would we say in this language, we are good children? We would say spaghetti are good children. Not spaghetti is, spaghetti are good. I mean, that's the, we just replace we with spaghetti. Okay, now, the kids in the bilingual groups consistently were shown to be better at doing this substitution. But of course, and the monolinguals had a harder time. And the harder time comes from the fact, and we as adults also have harder time to, like, you know, maybe do the task, because we are distracted by the meaning. Okay, spaghetti are good children, or spaghetti is good children, doesn't make sense. So we've got a conflict. We've got a conflict with meaning. And the tendency is, you know, not to be able to, like, dissociate the effect of meaning and the effect of form. But bilingual children are quite good at doing that. Another type of task that illustrates the same, you know, good management ability of bilinguals in dealing with meaning and form dissociations has to do with tasks like the ones you see in one and two. Okay, so if you look at one, apples growed on noses. Okay, this is an ungrammatical sentence. We call it ungrammatical because it doesn't follow the rules of English. Rules of English say that the verb grow has a past tense grew and not growed. Okay, so this is grammatically wrong. It is not produced by the grammar of English. Okay, now the sentence two, apples grow on noses, okay, is perfectly grammatical. It's a good sentence of English. Other famous sentences that have been discussed in this context are by Chomsky, you know, colorless green ideas sleep furiously, which is a bit nonsensical, but it is a fully grammatical sentence of English. So the little machine that we have on the brain and its grammar produces this sentence. So they did tests. They established that children are able to distinguish what is grammatical and what is wrong. So the use of the wrong tense is bad, it's incorrect, okay. And so they wanted to ask the kids whether a sentence is correct, grammatical, or incorrect, ungrammatical, okay. And so the correct answer here is to say that one is incorrect, but two is correct. All right, but we have a misleading cue here, the meaning. The meaning doesn't make sense. So if you cannot dissociate meaning from form, you're going to say that apples grow noses is incorrect. Okay. Now, the bilingual children, again, consistently have shown to be better at being able to give the answer correct to this type of sentence. And by giving the answer correct, they tell us that they're able to distinguish between grammatical correctness and, you know, semantic correctness. Okay, and one final task that I wanted to show was, again, that illustrates that the bilingual children are better at tasks that have to do with dealing with conflicting cues, which has to do with the fact that they need to deal with suppressing their other language. So in a task like this, where, you know, this is the hidden pictures. Those of you who had children probably, you know, have played hidden pictures with them extensively. So here we see the clock, the face of the clock, and then we see a tent, or this little triangle there in red. Okay. And so this is the embedded figures test. We see two representations here. Okay, one is the clock, and the other one is the triangle. Okay. Now, there is no conflict between the two of them because one is embedded into the other. Okay. No conflict, so I can see both the clock and the triangle. Now, in this type of task, bilinguals, and now bilinguals are the light blue, and monolinguals are the red. Okay, and we number the number of correct responses that they gave, depending on whether they guessed the second picture or not. So what we see here is that there is no difference between monolinguals and bilinguals in this type of task, okay, which requires that you just see two. Now, monolinguals and bilinguals showed effects in tasks that involved ambiguous figure reversals, okay, and these are tasks that require suppressing one interpretation in order to see the other one, okay. So just to illustrate, so we see here four such examples. Some of you might have even, you know, seen some of these in your lives as students. Okay, so we see here the ambiguous images. They play with shadow and foreground, with various other properties. So we see, now take, you know, the one, this one is one of my favorite. So what do you see? A woman's face. Uh-huh. What else do we see? A saxophone player. Okay. Now, when we see, so it doesn't matter who we see first, so when, but when we see the one, we don't see the other. Right? In order to be able to see the one, you need to suppress the other. And likewise, in the other one, we see either a vase or, you know, the profiles of two people looking at each other. And again, in order to be able to see the two faces, you just look at the light parts. In order to be able to see the vase, you look at the dark part, the shadowed. Okay, so in order to be able to see each representation, and likewise an old man and a mouse and a duck and a rabbit over there. So in order to be able to see one image, you need to suppress the other. Okay, so bilinguals have been shown, these little flowers over there indicate statistical significantly, a statistical difference that is significant. Okay, and we see there that the bilinguals actually did show an advantage. I mean, they scored higher in uncovering those ambiguity in the pictures than the monolinguals. The monolinguals are the red, and the bars are almost all of them lower. Okay, and these facts, again, this is early, this is research from the mid-90s, and a lot of it, again, has been replicated. So, and then I'm leaving the podium to let Said do the rest of the talking. So bilingual children do have an advantage in discovering alternative interpretations. Okay. And they can more easily than bilinguals inhibit or suppress existing interpretations. Okay. So they are mentally more flexible in this sense. And we can see what potential this may have, okay, when we move to, say, judgment, culture, and other things. I should also mention here, we didn't talk about this at all, but there's also research that has been done in this university by Boas again, on how speaking a second language can actually remove biases, okay, from making judgments, making moral judgments. And, you know, we got him here. If you guys have any questions about that, he'll be happy to answer any questions you might have. But this is, again, a very interesting point in that shows that the language that you speak, okay, or the fact that you speak a language that is second to you or different from the one that you've been accustomed to, okay, affects not just, you know, the way you speak, which is kind of expected, of course it does, but it affects more generally the way you make decisions or the way you perceive things or the way you build interpretations about, you know, the world around you. Okay, so at this point, we're ready to talk about how language or bilingualism can be used in transforming, you know, the creativity process in art. Okay.
Yeah. Sorry?
You want to sit or stand?
I've never been scared of bilingual people as I am today.
Why was I scary?
Really bilingual? No, you were fine. But I was thinking about all the bilingual people that I know.
Yeah, okay, there we go.
And the interpretation. Bibi Netanyahu is bilingual.
I guess he speaks very good English, that's true, yeah.
You can think about, yeah, occupational democracy, can, it's a saxophone and
yeah,
and the lady.
Right, so you can have a double, yeah.
Well, I guess by way of transitions, or what, first of all, Anastasia and I are never, we never miss a chance to lobby for bilingualism and speaking in the United States. It's still a very strong bias, cultural bias historically against bilingualism, and even in today's kind of educational system, it's something, so we always kind of take that, that's part of what you heard here. But the other part is that we wanted to kind of, this is when you say the words bilingualism lab, this is the kind of knowledge that these laboratories produce, and this is kind of the methods that they use. They will take children, show them pictures, you know, measure stuff that's happening in their brain, or construct graphs with, you know, the count, right, statistically, how much they answer correctly, and that what we're trying to do kind of with the support of the Gray Center is really kind of to take a step into a void in some sense and try to say, okay, what would the humanistic bilingualism look like, bilingualism lab look like? And what would it mean to create a lab that would serve somebody like Said, for example, or serve a conversation between us? And what would we do there? And it's still an open question. We're not going to
show people pictures of the duck rabbit and ask them to see how prevalent, what answers they give, and by that learn something about the bilingual brain. But we may be thinking of the duck rabbit as a kind of metaphor, a useful one for thinking about a bilingual narrative, one that somehow contains conflicting tendencies or conflicting perceptions of the world. And that's the place where we want to start kind of, today's conversation is one of our first experiments with this, to bring Saïd into the conversation and to say, to sort of ask some questions about the degree to which bilingualism is really a relevant category for you when you think about your work, and how it's formed. You're also kind of a multimedia artist, right? You write novelistic prose, but you also write for television and you also write journalism. So how bilingualism plays a very different role in these different contexts for you. So maybe that's a place to start. If you could tell us a little bit about how that works for you, when and where you mix languages, and how you do that.
Okay. If we can enhance this question, like in what sense the TV series that he has produced, for example, had it been monolingual, how is it different now that it is bilingual than, you know, it would have been had it been monolingual?
Yeah, could you create Arab labor as a monolingual text, as in one language only?
No.
No.
No, it wouldn't look natural at all. I do have Arab characters, Palestinian characters, and Jewish characters, Israeli characters, and it really doesn't look natural. And I usually hate movies like the movie I may have, that everyone there speaks even English, not to talk only about Arabic and Hebrew. Yes, it wouldn't look really. It would be very sad and miserable. And it's the fact that every one of the Arab characters, at least, they mix or they choose to mix in a different way the Hebrew with the Arabic. For example, Amjad, who's the main protagonist, is doing his best to fit in, to be accepted by the Israeli Ashkenazi society, so he would use more Hebrew words when he talks in Arabic. Amal is supposed to be a little bit more militant, nationally aware, so she's doing her best not to mix any Hebrew when she speaks Arabic. And Bushra, his wife, she would use Hebrew only when she's talking about professional her job, so she doesn't know the professional terms and expressions in psychology, for example. So she uses Hebrew because she studied in a Hebrew university, for example. And so of course it wouldn't look natural. It was a little bit scary. I do remember with the very beginning with the pilot, and it was a new project. And I remember that we were asked to use only 20% in the show, in the pilot.
How did they come up with that number?
I don't know.
Only 20, in accordance with the population?
So it was just the pilot, because they were scared. Some of the people, they were a little bit afraid that Israeli viewers would turn off the TV because they are not ready or not used to listen to Arabic in the Israeli TV. I knew that it's a mistake, because I do remember that most of the Israelis did watch the Egyptian movie. It was this institution of the Egyptian movie every Friday afternoon, and they did watch it. It's true that back then we had only one channel, the Israeli channel, and that was the only thing that you can watch on TV. And also the Israelis are not like Europeans or the Americans. They are used to read subtitles. And so I knew it's a mistake, but the pilot, unfortunately, yes, we did like that. And we were making fun on the set that did we pass the 20% Arabic. And it felt really not natural. And they invented some things in the pilot. I remember that they go to fix the car, and the father is telling his son in Hebrew. He speaks only Hebrew because he doesn't want the customers to run away, or something like stupid things like that. But it was only the pilot, and then I know very well that I talked to the actors before the shooting. Said, "Okay, we reached that level. we're not going to say no because of that. Let's do the pilot, and everyone in the show is going to talk the way he should talk, mm-hmm. in a natural way. So the pilot is usually the pilot is not something that you broadcast, but it was. But mm-hmm. it's not because it was that good. It was we're talking about a very cheap production. So yes, and it's. So yes, the mix, the mixture of Hebrew and Arabic for the Arab characters themselves is very much calculated in the mm-hmm. TV show, and so I'm not sure if it can work if it was not a mixture. It is about identity and it's about crisis and it's about political situations. So it's, and language is part of it. It's true, and it's really much more natural for me to write. To write a script mixing dialogues in Arabic and Hebrew. It's much more natural than writing a novel, and then I do have Arab characters in the novel, and I do have dialogues between the Arab characters, and they have no other choice but to write it in one language. And of course it's Hebrew, because I'm not sure if there were written bilingual novels till now. So it's a big struggle, and I have a very strong feeling that in this the new novel that I'm working on, I was supposed to be working on. somehow living in Champagne brings you back to literature, and yes. So I think that the protagonist there is going through a. A process that by the end of the novel he understands that he cannot use Hebrew anymore, so it should switch. But I'm very much aware of the difficulties of writing a bilingual book. Otherwise, it would look like Rashi or with explanations about every word. So it's. Three different books for one novel, and usually it should be just a love story or something like that. So it should be one language. But yes, I think that the best way that I feel with this protagonist is toward the end he starts mixing Arabic in the novel, and towards the end he will write it in Arabic, and I'm not sure, and I don't know if the readers should understand or they shouldn't understand, and I'm not sure how is it going to be translated, if at all. So it's a lot of challenge. It is true that when writing Dancing Arabs and all of the novels, it was frustrating to imagine the exact words that I know and I can hear my grandmother saying only in Arabic, and then I have to translate it. It was a little bit of cheating. It's only the dialogues, actually, more than anything else. But it's really, we were discussing all of these things just recently with Anastasia and Na’ama, and they were asking so many questions that I'm not sure that I was aware of, and it's a little bit scary. The mechanism of taking decisions while writing, using both languages, thoughts about the limits and the freedom, and how do I create my characters? And I think yes, it seems like it's because usually I'm just a storyteller, and I don't think about while writing. I'm not sure how much I do think about it. And as I told Na’ama and Anastasia yesterday, I think yes, one of the reasons that. It's true. I didn't choose to write in Hebrew. My parents just decided one day to send me to a Jewish boarding school, and it was the first time for me really to see a library and start reading books. And all the books were in Hebrew, and so I started writing in Hebrew. And it was some kind of the natural thing to do. Although I'm not sure if natural is the right word about it, but in a sense. When I write Hebrew, I guess it gave me some kind of freedom, because I thought I can write about difficult things. I can write about, maybe I thought when I didn't come from a religious background, but I did grow up in a very conservative village and aunts and school, and then I got to a boarding school in Jerusalem, so it was the big city. So probably yes, probably I felt more free to express myself or write in Hebrew because maybe I thought if God understands Hebrew, it means that God is Jewish and I'm screwed anyway, and he's Muslim, he's really not supposed to be now reading high school stories in Hebrew. So maybe that's the reason. It's much easier for me to talk about or write about alcohol or love and in Hebrew, because but maybe it is cheating. Maybe to confront with your thoughts and ideas and I don't know, the issues that I'm dealing with in my writing. Maybe the right way was yes to choose the words with the painful, scary, sometimes even more, but words in Arabic. To say Allah in Arabic got a different meaning for me than when I say Elohim in Hebrew. Mm-hmm. And not that I have anything against, just an example. I just don't want to say sex. And so.
And there you just did.
No, in Arabic. So yes, maybe, but on the other hand, also, I feel I'm not sure about the use of the Hebrew is how much I'm aware of the audience or at least the immediate readers of my novels or materials or columns in the newspaper when I choose Hebrew. So because I'm talking to the Israelis, and you have to find a specific way to address Israelis. When I choose to write in Hebrew, I'm not sure if I choose to write in Hebrew. Did I also choose the way of writing? Maybe I'm using a lot of humor in order in Hebrew also to make the mainstream Israeli or the Israeli reader, mainstream Israelis when we talk about the TV show, but the Israeli readers when we talk about the novels, to be convinced. Maybe I need the Hebrew. Maybe I need to humanize first the characters, mm-hmm. and then to try to tell a story in Hebrew. And then maybe there are really the limits and how much of the language that I use, because there are so many expressions and words, new words in Hebrew, and it's only in Hebrew to talk about occupation. In Hebrew we have so many words to make awful things sound a little bit more easier, like chisuf and, you know, v'kibush nor v'kel. So I
various euphemisms for the political situation.
So yes.
Maybe we'll open it up to some questions since we have about 10 minutes late left. Yes, Steve.
When you write in Hebrew, do you write in translation or do you think in Hebrew?
Sorry?
When you write in Hebrew, do you write in translation or do you think in Hebrew?
I never felt that I'm translating anything. I write in Hebrew immediately. Some people who know me very well say that I don't even think, but it's I do. I think more while writing, but no, I never felt. But again, I think that this is the something. This conversation we just I had with Na’ama, it's about this mechanism of translation that maybe I'm not aware of. And you know, in Israel, I was asked so many times, in what language do you dream? Also, because there is a very famous Israeli song in the night, I still dream in Spanish, Bisparadi.
Yes,
so everyone, like that was, I wrote actually in my column, please don't ask me in what language I dream, because for many Israelis it's okay, if he dreams in Hebrew, so he's completely with us, but if he still dreams in Arabic, and we know what is the typical Arab dream. And for many years, because I was really very worried about it, I know that this night I'm gonna dream, and I'm going also to remember in what language I had that dream, and I never managed to remember, to know in what language I dream. Sometimes I feel like if it's Israeli Jews who are running after me, so I beg for my life in Hebrew, and if it's Arab chasing after me, so probably it's Arabic. But what I'm trying to say, and maybe I'm wrong, because I'm not basing that on any research. And one of the things that I will try maybe to figure out during this this class is, I think that thoughts are prior than language. I think that I have a feeling that I translate the thoughts, that I choose to translate the thoughts. It's not that I think in a language. I think in visuals and feelings and visions, or I don't know, not visions like prophets, but you know, you see the characters doing something, and then I choose to translate it. And since I'm writing in Hebrew, so I translate it in Hebrew. It's much more difficult when I'm talking about real characters, like again that I mentioned my father or my grandmother, and and I mentioned Dancing Arabs because it was some kind of semi-autobiographical novel, and I really wanted to use the same powerful words that I heard in my childhood, but I couldn't do that. So never felt like translating. It's only the dialogues. Again, dialogues that I should use from my grandmother. It's the only times that I felt that I'm now translating something from Arabic. Dialogues only, and not thoughts. And I think that I mix a lot of Arabic in Hebrew letters in my writings and in my novels, just to let them know that it was said in a different language. And I remember in the first novel there was a discussion with the director if we should translate the meaning in Arabic, and we decided not to do that, just to make it look natural. So I mixed a lot of Arabic words in the Hebrew first novel that I used, and in three novels, without explaining not the meanings. And I'm not talking about Arabic words that most of the Israelis know. So yes, it is.
Yes, in the back.
You are not bilingual. You are multilingual. Your English is very good too. Which other languages do you speak, and which writers have influenced you, and in which languages do you read them?
Sorry, didn't understand your question. No. No way. I do translate when I. Trust me, you can ask my students in Champagne. I promised all of them A+. That's the reason. I really don't know if I'm influenced by writers. Maybe I was influenced by writers when I was younger, I'm always in love with a different writer. Since there was the new translation of Oblomov,
mm-hmm.
Since then I love him because author. He sleeps a lot. But I usually would say that writers starting with K in Hebrew are like Kafka, Gutsi. It's also start with K. Hanif Qureishi was really very good. Edgar Keret also with K, he's very nice. Yoshua Knaz is also with a K. Italo Calvino, we write in Hebrew also with a K. Also great.
All the C's that become K's.
Sorry?
All the C's would be K writers.
In Hebrew?
In Hebrew?
Yes. Yeah.
Therefore,
no. Yes. Mm-hmm. And I have to change it to C maybe in English. Who cares about Kashua? Anyway, in my Russian, we cheat with Q. So, but at the beginning, when I remember that, really, as I mentioned, I remember very well. I probably, if I read now the Kachar and the Rai again, the Rai?
Right.
I would hate that novel. Maybe, but I'm not going to read it again because I read it. It was the first novel in Hebrew that I read, and probably maybe the first novel ever that I read when I was sent to that school. Sorry?
Kachar and
the Rai. J.D. Salinger.
Yes, it was in Hebrew. And I remember that I really didn't know that you can talk like that, and you can curse like that, and you can be mad like that. And that was one of the reasons that I started to get in love in literature. The first novel maybe I read, and it was in Hebrew. And then, of course, there are so many Israeli writers that I read during the high school, and maybe that was the reason that I also felt I have a different story to tell. If it's Aaron Meged and even Meir Shalev and David Grossman, the Damos Oz, I was reading them and thinking I have a different story. My grandmother told me a different story, and I have to write it, and maybe in Hebrew, because back then I really believed it's just to tell the people another story or a different story. Since then, I'm trying to tell a different story. It doesn't really it doesn't really work. But I'm trying to do my best to read, and you know, I'm always shocked to discover that this writer that I really love is also a Jewish writer. I remember when they told me that Kafka was Jewish, because I really don't know. Mm-hmm. I really don't know. I'm that naive that I can read Shalom Aleichem and think that he's, I don't know, not Jewish. Like Saul Bellow, the first book, it was Herzog, and they thought it's about the President Herzog of Israel, and it was great. And even Philip Roth, I was reading about Jews in New York, and I was laughing out loud, and I needed someone to tell me, you know, he's Jewish himself. So many Jewish writers and minority writers, I guess, and they very much love the way that Alexander Hemon, citizen now of Chicago, writes. And but to be honest, I think that I'm in my stories, I'm more influenced, you know, by the guy in the supermarket and the lady who sells me the cigarettes and champagne and the barber, how's the barber?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Hairdresser?
No, it's not a hairdresser, trust me.
Barbarian.
More than things that I read. And sometimes I feel that I'm inspired by Lieberman and Bibi Netanyahu more than any literature. I'm scared, and fear is a wonderful inspiration.
Yes.
More questions here?
Yeah, go ahead.
So in this talk so far, you've talked a lot about how language is shaped, the decision to use the language is shaped by how others will perceive what you're saying. And I know you work a lot on identity, so sort of looking more internally, how do you feel like choosing the language shapes maybe your identity or the identities of your characters?
I think that identity is made of many different...
Yeah, so let me just offer one general comment on this to make it a little more easy.
I know the right answer.
Yeah, so when we think about identity, we typically think about it in terms of a monolingual context. You know, often in such literatures, there is a great citation from Wittgenstein, the earlier Wittgenstein that is cited, which says that the limits of my language are the limits of my world. Which is wrong, in a sense that, I mean, we can talk about it, to what extent it's right and to what extent it is not. But the idea, again, is that, you know, you have one language and therefore one view of the world, and that somehow the individual defines itself through this unity, one, and the world, therefore, is one. I mean, you cannot have more than one world. So when we ask this question in the context of bilingualism, we have to accept that, you know, the limits of my language or the limits of my thought is not true, because here you've got two languages, still one world. But then it becomes a question of how do you perceive yourself as a bilingual in different spheres of that world, in different spheres of your life. And as I said at the beginning of my part of the presentation, the bilingual is not one plus one. Okay, so the bilingual experience through the day is, you know, you have these two languages with your Arab friends, you talk Arabic, or with your family, with your Israeli intellectual friends, with your Hebrew-speaking intellectual friends. With your Hebrew-speaking friends, you're gonna speak Hebrew. Okay, and if you've got a mixed company where they both are there with your grandmother who speaks Arabic, you're gonna go back to Arabic as well. So throughout your day, I can imagine that, you know, you define yourself, especially if you're a balanced bilingual, as Said is, you define yourself through, you know, both ways. But I think that there is a question there, do you compromise yourself? Like feeling that, you know, only part of your identity is exposed. Now think of what the research shows us. It shows us that even when we speak one language, the other one remains active. So it is not experienced. The fact that a bilingual uses one language at a given space and time is not experienced as a compromise of the other. In fact, it's so subconscious that you don't even know that you're just not using the other one and the other one is there. You see what I mean? So if we transfer that piece of knowledge to answer you know, the question, then maybe, you know, Said can tell us a little bit more about this.
Yes, but I agree with you very much, and I think that it's true, but it's that I am both. I cannot ignore that. I am a Palestinian citizen of Israel by definition. I know that I was born to an Arab-Palestinian family, and I'm carrying an Israeli passport. It's a fact. And sometimes, you know, this identity, sometimes it looks like if you are a minority, you are blessed, you don't have this privilege or the choice to define how to define what is your identity. The clerk, when you were born, just said you are Arab, and then you have to protect yourself. So in many cases, in my case at least, I feel like that the majority already told me what is my identity. But it's a problem, maybe, because here it's not only to be bilingual from two different, and we're talking here about Arabic and Hebrew, that as the nations are in a fight, so it's also to be some kind of binational. I'm not sure about that. So it's a mixture, and it's a little bit more complicated when we talk about the Jews, or I can be blamed of neglecting the Arabic language, or why did you choose to write in Hebrew? Again, I'm not sure that I choose that. And sometimes, yes, it's sometimes very difficult. And when I look at my kids, and they all much more like the, when I talk in Hebrew, they laugh at me because of my accent, and but when there is a crisis and you are trying to see the whole picture, and your goal is to create one kind of a narrative or a story that both nations can accept or live equally together. When we talk about narratives in Israel, it's a huge issue. And then when a crisis like last summer, I feel I wish I didn't talk that language. I wish that I was not bilingual or binational. I wish that I never taught my kids Hebrew. I wish I could stay in my village in Tira, because you immediately become two separated fighting camps. And that's very tragic, I believe, for most of the people who used to believe in peace, or both Arabs and Israelis. So it was a big crisis, and if you deal and if you are stuck, I hate to use the term stuck in the middle, which I never felt that I'm stuck in the middle. To be honest, I think that people were stuck around me, and they was have been always okay. So it's a problem. So in order to figure out how deep my identity problem is, I can tell you that I'm teaching Hebrew in Champaign, Illinois. I love Champaign, Illinois, by the way, really. And I'm very happy about it. And
how much are we allowed to go? I'm looking at the
we
watch.
We've got some questions, so we can take maybe two more.
Okay, sure, yeah. How about you in the end there?
I told him.
Oh, I'm sorry, yeah. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, he raised.
Just this all raises two levels of the conversation that seem to me so interesting. There could be, I imagine, a kind of a neutral bilingualism where you just happen to know two languages and you function equally in them. But then there's also this bilingualism where there are real power issues at stake, a conflict or identification with a minority, majority, or, I mean, in this case, too, of sort of concentric circles of, I mean, Hebrew, in terms of the Middle East, is a minority language. I mean, if you wrote in Arabic, you would have a much wider potential audience. But in the context of Israel, maybe not. But in
wrong.
The context of Israel, it's a minority language, and the power differential is very significant, and so it functions in a, you know, in a much more fraught kind of way. I think.
It's true, It's true, but you were wrong about if I wrote in Arabic, I would have much more readers. That's a mistake, unfortunately. I was really very shocked to discover that a bestseller in all the Arab world can be 10,000 copies for a book. And and in Israel, I can sell 80,000 copies for a book. It's amazing. And to because the reality in the Arab world, I very much hope that it's going to change. And so in that sense, it's a little bit different. But I live in Israel. I never felt like I live in the Middle East. We are disconnected from the Arab world totally, completely. We are not allowed, as citizens of Israel in that case, to be in contact or in touch with the Arab culture around us. And we don't have any publishing houses or any marketing for books in Arabic. I think one of the reasons, you know, it's also to try to to be able to affect the majority and to address the majority, and it's not always easy. But for a Palestinian writer inside Israel to publish a book or to do anything with literature is almost impossible. Again, we don't have bookstores, we don't have a marketing system there, and I'm not sure if we do get any kind of support, governmental support for writers there. So it's
maybe
it's also an issue.
And then Ms. Vaida, and then we're done.
Something you said about Allah and Elohim, and I wondered if what impact your bilingualism had on the vulnerability of your characters.
That's a good question.
Yeah, I don't know. It's something that I didn't know it's got something to do with bilingualism at all. I thought it's.
I've been trying to sell him that theory. But
yes, and actually, I was shocked now today. I would accept it. I have no idea. They are
vulnerable.
Yes.
Game.
And I was talking with Na'ama, and I discovered that maybe the reason that I have no idea what happened in the third novel to the character, it's based on the fact, till now I have no idea what really happened in that novel, which is okay, it's a great novel. You will enjoy it, because I don't know, because there is no decision, and I never knew what's gonna happen. I never planned what's going to happen to the characters in the next morning. But again, I'm really not sure. As I was talking here today, I'm really not sure if it's about bilingualism or my characters or my anti-protagonist characters that I'm using. Sometimes I'm a little bit criticized because why do you write such an erotic always characters, and they're Arabs, they have no, you know, no national proud,
pride.
Pride, yes. But again, I don't know if it's the language or it's the fact of being a really persecuted minority inside Israel. I don't know if it's the language or if it's the stories of my grandmother that really, from a very young age, I was listening about stories how my grandfather was killed during 48 and how she lost all her land. So I'm not sure how it's all mixed together, and maybe it's got nothing to do with Israel, Palestine. Maybe, as my father say, if I was born in a Chinese village in China and went to Chinese schools, I would become the same shitty person I am. So I don't like to blame it all in the language and Palestine, Israel. Whiskey can affect the mind as well.
That's right. So one last question, and then.
Well, I wanted to make a comment in that question. I don't think there's such a thing as bilingual neutrality, mm-hmm. because I think at least for children, you feel that one of your languages has more social register or whatever. I mean, that's just the way of saying it. And I was going to ask you if you feel that now that you're in the United States, if you might have more opportunity to develop a possibility of publishing in Arabic for the Arabic speaking population in the United States.
That's a good question.
Is that a possibility here?
You know, one of the things that you have to know about bilingual people, it's or at least one bilingual person. Sorry? You are? Yeah, like I do have some kind of values, and is it Hebrew or? But if they pay me, I would probably
have different values.
2 years writing, you know, languages that I couldn't imagine that I could use for writing. So all it needs is like a phone call and a figure and.
And it is important.
Yes, maybe. If I was approached, if I have a platform to do that, I might struggle somehow and find a way to do it. Mm-hmm. To be honest, I do. One of the things that I was willing to tell you is that it means that all of the Arabs are bilingual, even if they don't live in Israel. Because we do in the news listen to the Fusha Arabic, you know, the written Arabic language, and then at home we speak almost a different language.
Arabic is very famous to have this situation that we call diglossia, as a matter of fact. It's a kind of, it's the Greek version of bilingualism. So you've got the standard version, and then, you know, the other varieties that you speak at home, and they're very different.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I think that my mother tongue is the Palestinian accent or dialect, and I do use it in films and TV show, and it's just natural. But I'm really not sure how can I use it to write, because I didn't read a lot of Arabic literature since the age of 15, and I have to practice that. And I know how deep the problem is only when if I start trying to write something in Arabic, and I did try, and it was very difficult, almost impossible. So.
Well, thank you so much.
Thank you.